Hello everyone and welcome back. Let us begin with a new chapter today, that is skeletal muscle relaxants. Coming to the outline of the chapter, we shall cover the classification of the drugs which are used as skeletal muscle relaxants, which are basically of two types, that is peripherally acting muscle relaxants and the centrally acting muscle relaxant. So we shall see in detail the pharmacology of the drugs which are used peripherally and the drugs which are used as central muscle relaxants. Okay, so peripherally in the sense their mechanism of action lies in the periphery, okay, that is outside the CNS, whereas the centrally acting muscle relaxants obviously are the those which will act in the CNS. Now these peripherally acting muscle relaxants again act by two mechanisms, so accordingly these are of two types: neuromuscular blocking agents and the directly acting muscle relaxant. So we are going to cover all of these in details, the individual drugs and the general pharmacology. So before going into the actual drugs, let us see what is the definition of skeletal muscle relaxants. So as I've told you earlier in the outline, that basically these skeletal muscle relaxants, that's this particular chapter is divided into two parts based on where exactly is the location or where exactly is the site of action of these particular drugs. Both of these classes result in the relaxation of the skeletal muscles, okay, but basically these are divided into two types based on how exactly they are acting. Okay, ultimate outcome is the relaxation of the skeletal muscles. So definition of the skeletal muscle relaxants is as follows: these are the drugs that act either peripherally at NMJ or muscle fiber, that is those drugs which can act at the NMJ, neuromuscular transmission is blocked, or these peripherally acting drugs can directly act on a muscle fiber so that it is relaxed. We shall see in detail how exactly, what is the mechanism by which they are resulting the relaxation as a result of action on NMJ or action on the muscle fiber directly, okay, or centrally. Okay, that is they act either peripherally at these two sites, either of these two sites. Accordingly, peripherally acting drugs are also divided into two types: those which act at the NMJ and those which act at the muscle fibers. Okay, or another part of the skeletal muscle relaxants is that these are the drugs which act centrally in the cerebrospinal axis, so as to reduce the muscle tone. So basal tone of the muscle is reduced. You all must be aware that any muscle has its tone. It's always in a partial contracted phase. Even if a muscle is relaxed, you cannot say that it is completely relaxed. There will be some basal tone in that particular muscle. Okay, so these skeletal muscle relaxants, they reduce this muscle tone and or causes the paralysis. That is, paralysis, it's a total relaxation, complete relaxation of a skeletal muscle. Okay, so what is the main aim of using these drugs is to either reduce the muscle tone or to cause the paralysis. That is, totally the muscles will be flabby, totally they will be relaxed. So based on the types of agents, okay, it are these particular class of drugs, these are divided into two: those which act peripherally in the periphery, okay, outside the CNS, and those which act centrally. Now these agents, neuromuscular blocking agents, that is these ones, the ones which act at the neuromuscular junction, these are known as neuromuscular blocking agent. They block the neuromuscular transmission. That is a mechanism by which the neuronal action potential or the impulse, nerve impulse which is brought, that signal which is brought, okay, so that is not transmitted to the muscle. Usually what happens, any neuron will bring an impulse, that's a neuronal action potential, it gets converted into an muscle action potential. Of course, we will see how exactly it takes place. You all must have already studied this under your anatomy and physiology of the skeletal muscles also. So how exactly this NMJ functions, or how exactly the signal is transmitted. So these particular drugs, neuromuscular blocking agents, as the name implies, these are the drugs which will block the transmission at the NMJ, so that the nerve impulse is not transmitted to that muscle, the signal is not reaching your muscle, so that the muscle action potential is not generated. So these type of drugs are mainly used in conjugation with the general anesthetics, you know, to produce the muscle relaxation for surgery. Now, whenever any surgery is carried out in a particular area, if the muscles, they have a tone, it becomes difficult to operate. So if the muscles are totally relaxed, or if they are totally paralyzed, it becomes easier for the operative procedures to be carried out. So generally, neuromuscular blocking agents are utilized for this particular purpose. Nowadays, of course, there are general anesthetics which have themselves have the muscle relaxation property also, but not all the general anesthetics have skeletal muscle relaxation properties. Okay, so for that matter, an additional drug has to be given along with the general anesthetics, that is the neuromuscular blocking agents are used for this particular purpose. Then the centrally acting muscle relaxants, these are mainly used to relieve the painful muscle spasm if has taken place, or any kind of spastic neurological conditions, to treat these type of conditions, the centrally acting muscle relaxants are utilized. Okay. So with this background, let us see which are the different agents which are used as skeletal muscle relaxants. So as we have discussed earlier, coming to the classification, basically this chapter will be divided into two parts, that is peripherally acting muscle relaxants and the centrally acting muscle relaxants. Okay, now let us see how exactly peripherally acting muscle relaxants are subclassified. So these are of two types. The first subtype of peripherally acting muscle relaxants is the neuromuscular blocking agents, and the second one is the ones which are acting directly on the muscles. Okay, so the first subclass of peripherally acting muscle relaxants, it is the neuromuscular blocking agent. Now these neuromuscular blocking agents again are of two types. Okay, depending upon how exactly they are producing the blockage, there are two different mechanisms by which the blockage can take place. Okay, so accordingly, neuromuscular blocking agents are again subdivided into two types, that is non-depolarizing blockers, or these are also known as competitive blockers, and the second subclass of neuromuscular blocking agents, it is the depolarizing blockers. Okay, so non-depolarizing, meaning here depolarization does not take place, they directly block the receptor, whereas depolarizing blockers, meaning they block the receptors, but before that they produce the depolarization. Now what do you mean by depolarization? In an action potential, whenever there is a change in the potential, okay, so whenever there is an action potential, okay, this particular phase, this is a depolarization phase, right? There is a particular resting membrane potential. So whenever there is movement of ions across a plasma membrane, say for example sodium ions, if it moves, it's an extracellular ion, when it moves inside the cell, obviously there is a movement, or there is a change in the charge, right? A positive charge is moving from outside towards the inside of a cell. So obviously this resting membrane potential, it will change, right? It will move towards the positive side. Okay, so this particular phase is known as the depolarization phase. Okay, so these particular agents are non-depolarizing blockers, meaning they abolish this depolarization. That is, the development of an action potential is prevented. Action potential, it has the depolarization phase, wherein the potential changes towards the positive side. This is mainly due to the movement of the sodium ions across the membrane. So because of this sodium ion movement, potential changes towards the positive size, and the when the potential crosses a particular critical level, threshold level, it results in the generation of an action potential. So after some time, what will happen? Inactivation of sodium ion channels will take place, opening of the potassium ion channels will take place, and repolarization will take place. Okay, so here the potential comes back to normal. It comes back to the resting membrane potential. Okay, so these, as the name implies, non-depolarizing blockers or competitive blockers, means here your antagonist is directly blocking your receptors. No depolarization is produced over here. Now further, these non-depolarizing blockers are divided depending upon what is the duration of action. Okay, say for example, first subclass is long acting. So obviously, as the name implies, this D-tubocurarin or pancuronium, doxycurium, pipecuronium, these are longer acting agents. Next subclass is intermediate acting. So this will act for a little bit shorter period of time. Examples include vecuronium, etracurium, cisetracurium, rocuronium, rapacuronium. And the third subclass is the short acting agents, that is mevacurium. So all these agents are the non-depolarizing blockers, or these are also known as competitive type of blockers. Okay, so all of these belong to the neuromuscular blocking agents. But how they act? They act in a non-depolarizing manner. Whereas the second subclass of the neuromuscular blocking agents is the depolarizing blockers. So here, as the name implies, these produce the depolarization. Okay, just like acetylcholine, it produces the depolarization when it is released. Similar way, these agents, that is succinylcholine, it is also known as succamethonium, and SCH is the accepted short form for this. And the second example is decamethonium. So these two are depolarizing blockers, that is they will produce the block, but initially they result in the depolarization, similar to the acetylcholine. We will see in detail how exactly these depolarizing blockers are also producing the neuromuscular blockage. Okay, then the second type of class. So far what we have seen under the peripherally acting muscle relaxant, the first class was neuromuscular blocking agent. And the second type is the directly acting agents. Okay, so these agents, obviously, as the name implies, they will directly act on the skeletal muscles. They are not acting through neuromuscular junction. But how they are acting? They are acting directly on those skeletal muscles, as a result of which they will relax. There are two examples over here, dendrolene sodium and quinine. Then, coming to the second part of the chapter. Okay, so far whatever examples we have seen are the peripherally acting muscle relaxant, which are of two types, neuromuscular blocking agents. Second one is the directly acting agents. Now, the second type of skeletal muscle relaxants are centrally acting muscle relaxants. So as the name implies, these are the drugs which have their site of action in the CNS. Okay, now again, these can be subclassified into first one, that is mefenacin congeners. Examples are mefenacin, carisoprodol, chlorzoxazone, chlormazenone, and methocarbamol. Then the second subclass is benzodiazepines, the BZDs, which we have covered under the sedative hypnotics, barbiturates and benzodiazepines. So diazepam is the most commonly utilized benzodiazepines, and of course others also have skeletal muscle relaxant property. Third subclass of centrally acting muscle relaxants is GABA mimetics. Examples is baclofen and thiocolchicoside. And the fourth subclass is the central alpha 2 agonist. Okay, so as the name implies, it stimulates this alpha 2 subtype of adrenergic receptor. Example is tizanidine. So with this, we shall start with the first part of the chapter, that is peripherally acting muscle relaxants. So as I've told you earlier, peripherally acting muscle relaxants, these are divided into two types, that is neuromuscular blocking agents and directly acting muscle relaxants. So as the name implies, neuromuscular blocking agents are those which will block the transmission at the neuromuscular junction. Whereas directly acting muscle relaxants, these are the ones which will act directly on the muscles so that they will result in the relaxation. Okay, so let us start with the first part, that is the neuromuscular blocking agents. Okay, so to go back into the history, how exactly these neuromuscular blocking agents were discovered. It was Curare which led to the discovery of this particular class of drugs. So this term Curare, this indicates the type of plant extracts which were used by the tribals. South American tribals used these as an arrow poison for hunting. Actually, the animal actually did not kill the animal, but the animal got paralyzed, as a result of which the animal could not run away and they could easily catch the animal. Okay. Now, earlier in the olden days, the arrow poison, it was obtained, this curare, it was obtained from sources like Strychnus toxifera, Condodendron tomentosum, etc. And the principal constituents which were actually responsible for this paralyzation, these are the tubocurarin, toxiferin. These were the principles which resulted in the paralysis. Okay, so this tubocurarin, this was the first of its kind, the neuromuscular blocking agents, which was clinically used in way back in 1930s. And subsequently, a number of agents have been added to this particular list. So we have seen that neuromuscular blocking agents, whether it is a competitive blocker or the depolarizing blockers, there are so many examples of drugs which belong to this particular class. Okay. Now, coming to the mechanism of action of these neuromuscular blocking agents. Okay. So basically, the site of action for both of these, okay, that is the neuromuscular blocking agents, are further divided into two subclasses, as we have seen under the classification. The competitive blockers, or these are also known as non-depolarizing blockers, and the second one is the depolarizing blockers. So for both of these types of neuromuscular blocking agents, the site of action is the end plate of the skeletal muscle fiber. Okay, so NMJ is the basic site where these particular blockers act. So we will see mechanism of action of both the types of drugs. Okay, non-depolarizing blockers as well as depolarizing blockers. Both of them act by different mechanisms. Site is same, but they act in slightly different manner. Okay, coming to the first type, that is a non-depolarizing block or the competitive block. Usually, this particular type of block is produced by the curare-like drugs, and the site, that is NMJ, was actually the site of action of these particular drugs. This was discovered by Claude Bernard. This particular scientist discovered by an experiment on the frogs he carried out, and he discovered that actual site of action is the neuromuscular junction which was getting affected. Now, before going into the actual block, how exactly the competitive blockers act, let us see first how exactly the muscle gets contracted. Okay, so you all must have studied this also in the skeletal muscles when you all have studied the anatomy and physiology. So this would be just a revision kind of. Okay, so before going into the blockage, let us see how exactly this receptor function, what exactly it is made up of and what exactly happens, how exactly acetylcholine is responsible for induction of the contraction of the skeletal muscles. Okay, so basically it is the NM receptor, the nicotinic NM subtype of receptor, which is located at the neuromuscular junction in the skeletal muscles, as we have seen under the cholinergic transmission. The cholinergic receptors are of two types, the muscarinic and the nicotinic. And anticholinergic drugs are basically the muscarinic receptor antagonists. And we had discussed over that the nicotinic blockers are either neuromuscular blocking agents, or they may be ganglionic blocking agents depending upon the subtype of nicotinic receptor. So this is the one which we will be focusing now. So in this chapter, skeletal muscle relaxing drugs, we are going to cover the part of anticholinergic drugs. Okay, that is those drugs which can block the NM subtype of receptor which is located on the skeletal muscles. Okay, so this particular receptor, it has been studied in detail and it has been found that this particular receptor, it's basically a protein which has 5 subunits. Okay, there are 5 subunits, membrane spanning subunits. As you all are all aware of, this is a lipoidal membrane. It's a bilayer structure of phospholipids and interspersed in between are different types of proteins. So these are the integral proteins which cross the membrane throughout. So there are 5 subunits which are placed close to each other. So all these 5 subunits have been studied in detail and it has been found that in NM receptors, there are 2 alpha subunits. These are the ones. 1 beta subunit, 1 gamma or eta subunit, okay, either of these, and 1 delta subunit. So totally there are 5 subunits which are placed, you know, if they are placed like a rosette surrounding a sodium ion channel. So there is a pore in between, aqueous pore. So this is crossing throughout the membrane, right? And as we all have seen that any charged material or any charged substance cannot cross the membrane. So how these ions will move through? They have specific ion channels. So this NM receptor is actually a sodium ion channel with 5 subunits which are placed like a rosette. 5 subunits are placed close to each other. Okay. And whenever acetylcholine binds to this particular receptor, actually, so acetylcholine structure, we have seen that it has a positive charge on it, right? It is acetylcholine chloride. So it's having a positive charge on it. So on these alpha subunits, 2 alpha subunits, they have a negatively charged group so that the positive head of the acetylcholine, it gets attracted towards this negatively charged group on the receptor. So when acetylcholine binds to these 2 subunits, what will happen? Acetylcholine, it has affinity for this receptor, that is, it can bind to the receptor, and it also has intrinsic activity, that is, it can induce the conformational changes in this particular receptor. Okay, so it's not only necessary to bind for an agonist to bind to the receptor, but it also should induce the conformational changes. So what this acetylcholine is doing to all these subunits, it is inducing the conformational changes in such a way that all of these subunits will move apart from each other. Okay, so this pore which was closed, now when acetylcholine binds to this receptor, conformational changes will take place. All of them have moved apart, as you can see. So the pore which is there in the middle, it will get opened and sodium ions will flow through. As such, sodium ion cannot cross the membrane, but it will flow through this ion channel. Okay, so this is how acetylcholine opens this particular channel. Now let us see how exactly a nerve impulse will make a muscle to contract. Okay, so usually the muscles, the skeletal muscles, these are supplied by the neurons, right? So this is an axon collateral of a somatic motor neuron. Okay, so it is supplying the muscle fibers. Okay, so this particular junction, usually the neurons and the muscles are not directly in physical contact with each other. So there is a gap over there in between. Okay, and that gap is known as the synaptic cleft in between these neuron and the muscle. Okay, so this particular entire structure is known as the neuromuscular junction, that is a junction in between the neuron and a muscle. Okay, so now let us see how exactly the impulse which is brought by a neuron, it gets transmitted into a muscle action potential and how exactly the muscle can get contracted. So whenever these neurons are stimulated, whenever they bring the signal of contraction of the skeletal muscles, so they will carry a nerve impulse, right? And nerve action potential will be there, which will be traveling through this axon and it will reach the axon terminal. Now this signal which is brought by this neuron, it will be transferred to the skeletal muscle with the help of release of neurotransmitters. As such, there is no physical contact over here. Okay, so whenever this nerve is stimulated, there are signaling molecules which are stored over here, right? So in the synaptic vesicles, we have seen acetylcholine is stored over here. Okay, so let us zoom this particular part. Okay, so in the synaptic vesicles, ACH is stored over here. So whenever there is a nerve impulse which is coming over here, it will result in the release of these neurotransmitters. So these vesicles will move towards this terminal wall of these axon terminals, and it will result in release of ACH by the process of exocytosis. We have seen the release of ACH. Okay, so with the process of exocytosis, this ACH which is stored in the membrane bound structure, it will be released into this synaptic cleft, into this space. So this ACH will travel further and it will bind to the receptors. So this is the ACH receptor or present on the skeletal muscle. So this is basically nothing but it's a sodium ion channel. Okay, so when two of the molecules of acetylcholine binds to one receptor, it will result in conformational changes. Channel will open. Now here the channel is closed. Once ACH binds, this channel will open and sodium ions will flow inside the muscle. So as a result of this, what will happen? There will be change in potential across this membrane, and it will result in generation of the muscle action potential. End plate potential will be generated and it will get converted into an muscle action potential, and it will result in contraction of this skeletal muscles. Okay, so basically this is how the acetylcholine makes the skeletal muscles to contract. Now coming back to the neuromuscular blocking agent, the first part, that is the competitive blockers. So these competitive blockers, they have the affinity for this nicotinic receptor, NM receptor, okay, at this muscle end plate, but they do not have any intrinsic activity. That is, the conformational changes will not take place. So sodium ion channels will not open. So as a result of this, there won't be any end plate potential which is generated. Okay, so most of these agents, they have two or more quaternary nitrogen atoms. So they will get easily attracted towards that negatively charged structure on the receptor, and it will get bound to that receptor. But because these competitive blockers, they have thick and bulky molecule, the conformational changes will not take place. So this particular structure, because they had a bulky molecule, the scientist Boverty named these as Pekhai Curare. This was the name given to these particular blockers. So as a result of blockage of this receptor, ACH which is released locally, it will not be able to combine with its NM receptor. Okay, so as a result of this, what will happen? End plate potential will not get generated because ACH is not able to bind to its receptor, right? So there won't be any opening of the sodium ion channels, no change in potential will take place. So end plate potential will fall below a critical level, as a result of which the action potential, the muscle action potential will not be propagated. So as a result of this, the muscle fails to contract and result in the relaxation of the skeletal muscle. Okay. However, this type of antagonism, it is surmountable. That is, when you increase the concentration of ACH in vitro, or if you add or administer anticholinesterases in vivo, it will result in the reversal of the block. It can take place. Okay. But at very high concentrations, if you are administering such type of drugs, such type of neuromuscular blocking agents, they will directly block the channel, and this particular blockage will be such small, strong that the neostigmine type of anticholinesterases, they will not be able to reverse the blockage completely. Okay, so this is to do with the competitive block or the non-depolarizing block. Now coming to the next mechanism of the depolarizing blockers. Okay, so depolarizing blockers, there are two examples, decamethonium and succinylcholine. So as the name implies, depolarizing block means these particular two agents, they have affinity towards your receptor, NM receptor, and they also have a submaximal intrinsic activity. What we have seen under the competitive blockers or non-depolarizing blockers, they have the affinity, but they do not have any intrinsic activity. But what is the difference between these two? Depolarizing blockers, they have submaximal intrinsic activity. Mind it, it is submaximal. These are not full agonists. They have submaximal intrinsic activity at this NM receptor. So what they will do, whenever they bind to this receptor, they will depolarize the muscle end plate. Actually, they will result in opening of the sodium ion channels, just like acetylcholine does it. Okay, so because of this, initially it will result in twitching and fasciculations. Twitching are the involuntary contractions of the muscles. Fasciculations also, if you can, you must have experienced sometimes, just beneath the skin, some skeletal muscles may contract and relax very rapidly. Okay, you will feel that particular contraction which is taking place. So those such type of contractions, involuntary contractions, are known as fasciculations. Okay, so these depolarizing blockers initially will result in twitching and fasciculation. They will result in contraction of the muscles. Okay, so they will result in repetitive excitation of these particular fibers. Okay, so the multiply innervated muscles. Okay, so for example, rectus abdominis of frog. This stimulation of this particular muscles will result in sustained contraction because of several neurons are coming in that particular area, right? If they are stimulated simultaneously, sustained contraction will be produced initially. Okay, so these particular drugs, that is depolarizing blockers, they do not dissociate rapidly from the receptor. They will bind to the receptor, stimulate that receptor submaximally, and they do not dissociate from the receptor. So what they will do, they will induce prolonged partial depolarization. This is not a complete depolarization, mind it, only partial, because they have submaximal intrinsic activity. Okay, so as a result of this persistent stimulation of the sodium ion channels, these sodium ion channels get inactivated. Okay, so initial stimulation of sodium ion channels will be there, just like your acetylcholine. But because of this repetitive stimulation, these sodium ion channels get inactivated after some time. So what will happen further? These, because of inactivation of the sodium ion channels, ACH, even if it is released, it won't be able to bind to the receptor. So muscle action potential will not be developed. As a result of this, flaccid paralysis will take place. So what is the difference between the two? The non-depolarizing blockers or the competitive blockers, they just bind to the receptor, block it. But the depolarizing blockers, they bind to the receptor, initially they will result in depolarization. And because of this prolonged depolarization, channel gets inactivated, and as a result of this, later on ACH is not able to bind to the receptor. Okay, so that's why you can see the initial fasciculations and the twitching. Before inducing the relaxation, they will result in contraction of the muscle, partial contraction. So as a result of their ultimate action, they will create a zone of inexcitability. So that particular area will not be excited by the acetylcholine, even if it is released in this area. Now, just like your non-depolarizing blockers, these depolarizing blockers also have two quaternary nitrogen atoms, which is required for attraction towards the receptor. So they have affinity, but their structure is long, slender and flexible. So it was termed as leptocurare by the scientist Bohr. Okay. Now, this depolarizing block in most of the species, okay, in the many of the species, these particular depolarizing blockers, they show a dual mechanism of neuromuscular blockage. That is, it basically produces the block in two phases. Okay, that is phase 1 block and the phase 2 block. Okay, now this phase 1 block, it occurs very rapidly. It has a rapid onset. That is, it starts very quickly, and it results from, why it occurs? It results from the persistent depolarization of the muscle end plate, and it has the characteristics of the depolarization block. That is, initially there will be contractions of the muscles. And immediately after a short period of time, this depolarization will decline and it will result in the repolarization. Okay, so gradually it will result in the repolarization, and further there will be initiation of the phase 2 block. Okay, now what is this phase 2 block? So initially there will be depolarization, and in the phase 2 block what will happen? It is actually slow in onset. Initially the depolarization will take place, so which is rapid in onset, but the phase 2 it takes a little bit time for it to start. Okay, so here what has happened, why this phase 2 block is taking place? It's because of the desensitization of the receptor to the ACH, as we have seen that in the first phase it is causing the depolarization, right? Okay, but later on what will happen, the channel gets inactivated, so it is desensitized, so that ACH is not able to bind to this receptor. So this particular second phase will resemble the competitive block, as if the competitive blockage has taken place. Okay, so that the ACH is not able to bind to the receptor, right? So that's what is happening under the competitive blockers, right? So similar type of action is seen in the phase 2. Okay, but it is slow to onset, okay, and basically results from the desensitization of the receptors. Okay, so this particular two types of blockers, as we have seen, the non-depolarizing blockers and the depolarizing blockers. What is the basic difference between them? These non-depolarizing blockers or competitive blockers result in direct blockage of the receptor. There is no stimulation, so directly they produce flaccid paralysis. Whereas depolarizing blockers, they initially stimulate the receptor partially, so they result in twitching and fasciculations, and later on they will result in flaccid paralysis. So this is due to phase 1 block and this is due to phase 2 block. So that's the difference between the two. Okay, so another table which shows the differences between the two, competitive block and the depolarizing block. Okay, so you can say that this is a difference between the D-tubocholine and the succinylcholine. So paralysis in various species, okay, it differs. In men it produces flaccidity, competitive blockers, whereas depolarizing blockers produce fasciculations and then flaccidity. Okay, but chick, it is little bit different. Even the isolated frog's muscle, okay, there is no contraction. But here in depolarizing blockers, it produces the contraction. The sensitivity of different species is also different for the two types of blockers. Okay, even the human neonates, it is more sensitive towards competitive block, and depolarizing block, it is relatively resistant. Okay, then neostigmine, it can antagonize this competitive block, whereas it cannot antagonize the depolarizing block. There is no antagonism which is produced. Okay, then ether anesthesia, it is synergistic with competitive block, whereas in case of the depolarizing blockers, there is no effect. Even the order of paralysis, that is order of involvement of various parts of the body, is also different. In case of competitive blockers, we can see fingers, eyes are affected first, then limb, neck, then face, trunk, and lastly the respiratory muscles. Whereas in case of depolarizing blockers, neck and limbs are affected first, then face, jaws, eyes, pharynx, next comes the trunk and the respiratory muscles. Okay, so order of involvement of different muscles, different skeletal muscles, is also different for the two. Okay, so let us start with the pharmacological action. So we have seen the mechanism of actions of both the non-depolarizing blockers and the depolarizing blockers. Now let us see the pharmacological actions. The first in and the very important one is the skeletal muscle. So already, as we have seen, the non-depolarizing blockers or the competitive blockers, they will result in muscle weakness followed by flaccid paralysis, and smaller muscles are affected first. Say for example, in the fingers and extraocular skeletal muscles are affected first. Okay, so paralysis, it spreads, then spreads to the hands, then feet, arm, leg, neck, face, then trunk, intercostal muscles, that is the respiratory muscles, okay, which are present in between the ribs, and finally the diaphragm is getting affected. So lastly the respiratory muscles are getting affected. These are last to get affected. So finally what will happen? Respiration will stop because the respiratory muscles are getting totally paralyzed. So obviously the person will not be able to breathe. So you should be very careful also while administering such type of drugs. Overdose will result in cessation of breathing. So they can be quite dangerous if they are administered in larger doses. Okay. Whereas the rate of attainment of peak effect, the maximum effect or duration of action, it will all depend upon which drug you are choosing, what is the dose which is used, which is the anesthetic which is used along with it, the hemodynamics, but the kinetics of the particular drugs, and the other factors like the renal status or the hepatic status of the particular person. Okay, so there are several factors which will govern the action. Okay, and the recovery from this relaxation, it occurs in the reverse sequence. That is, the respiratory muscles will recover first, then the trunk, then the facial muscles, then neck, leg, feet, arm, hands, and finally these fingers and extraocular muscles. Okay, so recovery will occur in the reverse direction. Whereas the depolarizing blockers, that is succinylcholine and dexamethasone, it produces fasciculations which last for a few seconds and then it induces the flaccid paralysis. As we have seen, because of the mechanism of action, it induces the depolarization and then it results in inactivation of the sodium ion channels which result in flaccid paralysis. Okay, then the sequence of the muscles which is involved, that is also different. Under table we have seen it is slightly different. Okay, but the action, the onset of action is so quick that it is sometimes difficult to even notice the difference in involvement of the different types of skeletal muscles. Then the apnea which is generated, it occurs within 45 to 90 seconds. So it's very quick in action. Apnea is the cessation of the breathing because of the relaxation of the respiratory muscles. Okay, so this apnea will be produced within a few seconds. Okay, but it lasts also for a shorter period of time. That is, recovery is also rapid from this depolarizing blockers. The next action is on the autonomic ganglia. So autonomic ganglia basically have the NN subtype of receptor. Okay, though it is a different subtype of receptor, still these can also be blocked by the competitive neuromuscular blockers. So as a result of this, ganglionic blockage will take place. Okay, whereas succinylcholine, it produces the depolarization, right? So it will produce ganglionic stimulation. So both have the opposite action. Okay, depending upon whether it is competitive blocker or whether it is a depolarizing blocker, different actions will be produced on the ganglia. The next action is histamine release. The D-tubocurarin, it releases histamine from the mast cell. Mast cell stores this histamine, so it results in release of histamine. So as a result of this release of histamine, hypotension is produced. Flushing, because of the vasodilatation, hypotension will be, that is pressure will decrease, flushing will take place, that is blood flow to especially the beneath the skin, it will result in increase in the blood flow to these regions, especially in the blush areas. So flushing will take place. Bronchospasm, the smooth muscles in the bronchi will contract, so bronchospasm will be produced and it will increase the respiratory secretion. Also, when you inject this D-tubocurarin intradermally, it will result in the wheal. We are all aware that histamine, when it is injected locally, or local release of histamine when it takes place, it results in a triple response. Okay, redness, wheal and flare is produced. Okay, so such type of, similar type of effect is seen when this D-tubocurarin is injected intradermally. Also, along with histamine, heparin is also stored in the mast cell. So that will also be released along with the histamine. Next effect is on the CVS. Now, D-tubocurarin, it results in significant fall in BP. Now, there are three reasons why BP falls. First reason is ganglionic blockage. Okay, due to the blockage of NN receptor, ganglionic blockage will take place. Histamine release produces vasodilatation. It will result in fall in BP. And the third reason is reduced venous return. Obviously, when venous returns is less, the blood which is pumped by the heart, that will also be less. So as a result of which the blood pressure also, if cardiac output reduces, obviously the blood pressure will also reduce. Okay, now why this venous return is reducing? Because the skeletal muscles are relaxed. Okay, so because of the paralysis of the muscles in your limbs, obviously there will be less of pressure exerted on the blood vessels. So there will be less of blood coming back to your heart. So this is one of the mechanism which will add to the venous return. Why the blood comes back against the gravity? Because your muscles are contracting on these blood vessels and the blood comes in the upward direction. Even there is a respiratory muscles, these also are responsible for inducing the pressure which results in venous return, the blood coming back towards your heart. So these are the two reasons why there is reduction in the venous return, and ultimately it will result in falling beating. Heart rate, it increases due to the vagal ganglionic blockage. Okay, now newer agents are there which produces less of cardiovascular complication. Whereas cardiovascular effects of the depolarizing blockers, that is succinylcholine, it results in bradycardia. Okay, so initially bradycardia, that is decrease in heart rate, will be produced due to the activation of vagal ganglia. Later on, tachycardia and rise in BP will be seen. This is due to the stimulation of sympathetic ganglia. Obviously, it stimulates the heart. There will be increase in the heart rate. Obviously, as a result of this, there will be rise in BP. Okay, so this is a complex action which is shown by succinylcholine. Usually BP may fall because of its muscarinic action resulting in the vasodilatation. Okay. Apart from this, cardiac arrhythmias or even cardiac arrest may also be precipitated, especially those patients who are suffering from burns, soft tissue injury and tetanus. Succinylcholine is responsible for this, prolonged administration of succinylcholine, so it should be avoided. Even efflux of intracellular potassium ions also occurs, so that hyperkalemia may also be precipitated. Next effect is on the GIT, ganglionic blocking action. It results in post-operative paralytic ileus, that is in the post-operative period there will be a paralysis of the smooth muscles in your ileum. Okay, so that the motility will get affected. Next action is on the CNS. Now, as such, we have seen in the structure it contains positively charged nitrogen atom, right? Quaternary nitrogen compounds these are. So obviously, when it has a charge, it cannot cross the blood-brain barrier. So even if you administer these drugs intravenously, there won't be any central effects. But if you apply them directly to your brain cortex, this will result in CNS stimulation. Okay, so this is to do with the pharmacological actions. Next is the interactions. Okay, so when simultaneously if these neuromuscular blocking agents are administered with some other drug, what are those interactions which may take place? So first interaction is of succinylcholine with thiopentone sodium. Thiopentone sodium, it is a general anesthetic. So usually this is also given by intravenous route. Succinylcholine is also given by IV route. So what generally is done is whenever feasible, the two drugs, if they are supposed to be injected, they can be mixed in the same syringe and they can be injected simultaneously rather than injecting two different drugs. But these two drugs should not be mixed in the same syringe because they react chemically. So both of them will not show the action. Okay. Next interaction is with the general anesthetics, along with which the neuromuscular blocking agents are used during the surgeries. So general anesthetics can potentiate the competitive blockers, okay, not the depolarizing blockers. Only competitive blockers can be potentiated. Their action will be enhanced. They will show more prominent competitive blockage. Okay. Next interaction is with the anticholinesterases. When anticholinesterases can be given, such as neostigmine, they can reverse the action of competitive blockers. As if you all can remember, under the mechanism of action, we have seen that competitive block is surmountable if you increase the ACH, and the action is also reversed by administration of the anticholinesterases in vivo. Okay, so it can reverse the action of competitive blockers. Under the uses of anticholinesterases also we have seen that they are used for decurarization, if you can remember. Okay, so to reverse the competitive blocker once the surgery is over, okay, to bring back the tone of the muscles, anticholinesterases can be given, neostigmine can be given. Next interaction is with the calcium channel blockers such as verapamil and others. These also can potentiate both the competitive as well as depolarizing neuromuscular blockers. Their action will get enhanced. Next interaction is with diuretics. It produces hypokalemia, which enhances the competitive block. Okay, so it can potentiate the competitive block because of hypokalemia, that is decrease in the potassium level. And then diazepam, propranolol and quinidine, these can also intensify the competitive block. So there are so many drugs which can potentiate the action of competitive blockers, whereas corticosteroids reduce the competitive block. Antibiotics such as aminoglycoside antibiotics, these reduce the release of ACH, okay, by competing with the calcium. So again it will enhance the action of these neuromuscular blockers. Even streptomycin, okay, this when it is administered along with the competitive blocker, it will show prolonged apnea. That is, competitive blocker's action is enhanced. That's why it is showing apnea. That is cessation of the breathing, because it shows enhanced relaxation of the respiratory muscles. Then tetracyclines, polypeptide antibiotics, clindamycin, lincomycin, all of them can also synergize with the competitive blocker. So you should be careful while administering the two together. Next concept is the toxicity, which may be produced by these neuromuscular blocking agents. So respiratory paralysis is a common problem, or prolonged apnea, that is breathing won't take place because skeletal muscle relaxation property, it will affect the respiratory muscles also, which are also skeletal muscle, which will, when relaxed, it will result in respiratory paralysis and prolonged apnea. Flushing is another common problem because of vasodilatation. Fall in BP and cardiovascular collapse may take place, especially if there is hypovolemia, that is decrease in the blood volume. Okay, with newer agents this particular complication is less likely, okay, excepting if there are some complications in the patient. Another problem is the cardiac arrhythmias or even arrest may take place with prolonged use of succinylcholine. Even succinylcholine releases potassium from the muscles. So as a result of this, hyperkalemia, one more complication, that is increase in the potassium levels may take place. Apart from this, histamine release is produced. So asthma can get precipitated. So these drugs are contraindicated in those patients who are suffering from asthma. Another problem is post-operative muscle soreness. Soreness meaning pain in the muscles may be complained after the use of succinylcholine as a muscle relaxant. Another problem with succinylcholine is malignant hyperthermia, that is increase in the body temperature may take place. Okay. Then coming to the uses, obviously the most important use of neuromuscular blockers is along with the general anesthetic. So as muscle relaxation is induced by these agents, and not all general anesthetics produce relaxation of the muscles so that it becomes easier for the surgeries to be carried out. So these drugs are very helpful. So they are given along with the general anesthesia to make it easier for the surgeon to carry out the operative procedures. So usually the competitive blockers, these are utilized for the surgeries like in the abdominal region or thoracic region, or some intubation or endoscopies if they are supposed to be carried out. Muscle contraction will take place and the patient may resist the intubation. So for this purpose also it can be used to relax the muscles, okay, in the neck. Okay. Then orthopedic manipulations also could be carried out under the influence of these agents. Succinylcholine, it can be used for minor procedures like endotracheal intubation, laryngoscopy, bronchoscopy, esophagoscopy, or for fractures, okay, fracture setting, dislocations and so on. Okay. For ocular surgery, usually competitive blockers are preferred because extraocular muscles are relaxed at very low concentrations. So little amount of drug may be required to relax these muscles without affecting other muscles. Okay, so you need to make a choice of your drug based on what is the onset of action which you require. Okay, what is the duration of action which you require, or which areas you need to get affected more. Cardiovascular complications, what type of drugs are producing cardiovascular complications, depending upon the patient situation. You can make a choice between the different agents. Next use is assisted ventilation. Okay, so those patients who are critically ill in the ICUs on ventilators. So generally what happens is patients' respiratory muscles, they may resist the ventilation. So to facilitate this ventilation, the muscles are relaxed, the chest wall muscles are relaxed so that the inflation becomes easier. Another use is to control the convulsions and trauma which may be induced by electroconvulsive therapy if it is supposed to be given. Succinylcholine may be used for this. So these muscle relaxants will, you know, to certain extent control this. Convulsions may not be induced or trauma may not be induced when skeletal muscle relaxants are used. Another use is the severe cases of tetanus and status epilepticus. Usually this tetanus or status epilepticus, it is treated by centrally acting muscle relaxants. But severe cases which may not be controlled by the centrally acting drugs like diazepam, you may paralyze these particular muscles by using neuromuscular blocking agents. Okay, so it could help these particular to control these particular situations. So these are the uses. We'll stop here. Thank you.